How are we doing, Spielberg?
It always takes longer than you.
That's what I always say to the girls when I take half an hour to come.
My name is Hollis Benton. I was born in England. I went to school at Eton College. I was in the army for 3 years. I came out here to be an actor, and then from 1980 to 1989, I had a very successful gallery, the Hollis Benton Gallery in Beverly Hills. Sold a lot of paintings, established various people like LeRoy, Neiman, and gave a lot of artists a break, which I'm very proud of.
Okay, let's go.
Come up with the name of a famous living American artist. Most people probably would have a tough time doing that, but if you mention art and sports, then the name LeRoy Neiman comes to mind. Neiman was at Seattle's Gallery back last week for the opening of his exhibit, and our Jeff Smith paid him a visit there.
This is Neiman. That's Neiman too. And of course this as well is the work of LeRoy Neiman.
You've been Playboy's artist in residence doing the Man at His Leisure series for almost 15 years now. You feel that man has developed any better at enjoying his leisure than he once did?
Well, sport life, sporting life, and love games and all that stuff with the aristocracy, all through the centuries was competitive.
It is an art career unlike any other. His work has been displayed in some of the great museums of the world.
Neiman just may have sold more art than any painter who ever lived. So he's a man who purports not to worry.
But it was great, actually. I mean, it was really, the art kind of really emblazoned the greed of the 80s, the art. It was just that kind of stuff, which was really good.
Hey, babe!
About as fucking low as you can go here. Kensington and Lehigh.
This is where Rocky was made, right there, man.
Oh, it's nice. Where? You gotta prove it to yourself,
just
right?
Just myself. No TV, no newspapers, just you and me.
Nothing, just you and me. Asian for beauty.
Anything you say, Stanley.
I do all the work, okay?
LeRoy Neiman, yeah. Both very interesting artists. I actually met them both up at Hefner's, and we became good friends. I put them in my gallery, and I then got him to know Hefner better. Ended up being Hefner's in-house artist. Did a lot of paintings for Playboy. And, well...
I'll just keep punching a ball.
Sylvester Stallone loved LeRoy Neiman, and he met him through me.
Come on.
And he took Stallone up to Hefner's, and he was on the set of Rocky, and he ended up doing a bit part as a fight announcer. So that was a perfect marriage of art and acting. He did a very good job, actually. He was a natural actor, LeRoy. He was very good.
Thunder lifts the ultimate male. See you next year. Thank God.
And he did a wonderful painting of Rocky with all the different colors. And
Boratine makes patterns blossom on all bright colors on white. And it makes all your stripes spring to life. So put Boratine in every wash and watch colors come alive.
Okay? Manipulation.
That's enough thinking. Watch. I'd also like you to thank my guests. The paintings of Patrick Nagel and, you too, CJ. Wasn't I more fun to work with than Bo Derek?
Good night!
Good evening. I'm Jason Robards. Join me as we watch dramatic illusions unlike any you have ever seen on television. Here now, the fourth of our annual visits to the magic of David Copperfield.
David Copperfield and Patrick Nagel had a very good, very long relationship.
And I can't remember exactly how it was, but how they exactly met. But they gelled very much, and it's almost like he tailored his art to suit Copperfield's tricks. It was amazing, actually. Very cool.
Patrick Nagel got on the cover of Duran Duran's Rio album. What was it like introducing Patrick Nagel to Duran Duran?
Well, again, it was just sort of a good marriage because Duran Duran's music, in a funny way, dovetailed in with Patrick's art.
So tell us a little of your background, if you will. You went to school here in Los Angeles?
Here in Los Angeles, to Chouinard in Cal State. I'm an L.A. kid. I grew up here.
For some reason, they just really liked Patrick's art.
The intrepid Molly caught up with Duran Duran in London.
In the show itself is visuals and music. It's not just music and it's not just a stage show. It's the two together, working together.
And it was just a natural thing that he would do the album covers, and it came out really well. I was very proud of him. It was just one of those good symbiotic things that happened because it tied in with that fucking decade. And we did the same too, and people were suddenly spending money. It was the first time that people were really spending millions of dollars on art, and I happened to be right there in the center of it, by luck and judgment, whatever. So, you know, I was really lucky. I had the 60s in England and the 70s in LA. It was great. Then the 80s came in, which was a really greedy decade, and AIDS came in, and it really fucked the whole thing up. But nothing will compare to the 60s in London and the 70s in LA. It was a fantastic time. Well, I guess I was lucky because I was one of the very first people to kind of tune in to TV, film, and art and put the three together. Martin Brest and I actually met at a dinner with Robert Graham. That's how we were introduced.
Can I get another drink?
I don't know. He became a good friend of mine. He was very into art.
Oh, man, I haven't seen Jenny in years. What's she up to?
He was a hot young director.
Manager of this art gallery, the Hollis Benton Art Gallery out in Beverly Hills. It's like a world famous place, right? You ever hear of it?
Yeah, I buy all my art there.
It may sound provincial, but I just stuck to Beverly Hills. I just stuck to the people I knew, the place I knew. I don't know, we became friends, and then he loved my gallery, and he ended up putting it in Beverly Hills Cop, where Eddie Murphy comes into my salon, and we have a long scene there. It was a very good plug for the movie. It was fantastic. I knew Marty when he was writing Beverly Hills Cop, and there was this gallery in the movie, which was quite important in the storyline.
How you got doing today?
Hi.
I'm fine. My name is Serge, and how can I help you?
Yeah, I'm looking for Miss Jenny Summers.
She's very busy today. Maybe you give me your name?
My name's Axel Foley.
Thank you.
there was a very good artist at that point, very famous, called Don Sorensen, who sadly died of AIDS. And he had a series of paintings based on the Greek temple. That was the format of his paintings. And I had a really good exhibition of those, and they almost all sold out. And his exhibition was going on at the time that they did Beverly Hills Cop. So, it was very good. It tied in extremely well. It was one of those things. And Don was a wonderful, wonderful artist. I mean, really brilliant. I miss him. I miss him a lot. Can I have the drink? Thank you very much indeed. All right. Are you on now? So I went to probably the best known school for con men in the world. And my parents had been involved in investing in films. Clockwork Orange was one of them. And I came up to Hollywood and I started acting. And I guess I'm a natural hustler, you know, because I learned that at Eton. I did some parts and got to know people, and I was interested in art, and I guess I knew I wasn't going to make that much money, and I started dabbling in art, and that's how it happened. But what brought me out here was being an actor, and you know, whatever takes you out here is what takes you out here, and it worked out well. You know, it's funny, I remember people like Larry Gagosian. I mean, he started off selling paintings on Venice Beach, and then he had a poster shop in Westwood, and the guy's done very well. You know, he's stuck with it. I mean, I'm finished now. I stopped my business, but we had a very good time in the 80s. I must say, when you're making money and you're at the top of the wave, it's a pretty neat time to be, you know, going to all the good restaurants. But you had to have money in the 80s to really appreciate it, you know? I was lucky, but I'm out of it now. So in 1988, I thought it'd be kind of cool to have a video exhibit, which very few people had done in those days. Showing based on Videodrome. It was a gamble, but it was a huge success. People really got off on it. It was really fantastic. It was totally inspired by the movie 5 years earlier. Mark Mothersbaugh was in Diva, and no one knew he was an artist. I did, though, and I really took a chance on him, and I put him in my gallery, and it was a fucking great success. Again, you've got to take risks if you're going to be an artist, whether you're a filmmaker or putting on a play or putting on stuff in a gallery. You've got to take risks. Just recently, we had this horrendous crash on the market. I mean, fuck. Everyone got wiped out. And I just knew it was the end of the road. I just knew it was time to close. I'd made my money, and I just knew the art world wasn't going to be the same again. So I got the fuck out of Dodge. I think I did the right thing, but it's very painful. It still hurts me. I decided to close. Finito. Okay. This is a famous joke. Got the camera going? You know, back in England when I was growing up, we had a radio show called 20 Questions with Gilbert Hardy, and they always asked for the object, and then this deep voice would come out and give me the object, and Gilbert Hardy said, the voice said, the next object is a 12-inch black cock, a 12-inch black cock, and they always had these very prissy, like Lady Isabel Barnett was the main one, so Gilbert Hardy said, let's start with Lady Isabel Barnett. And she said, is it animal, vegetable, or mineral? They always ask that. Is that a bit of each? Can you eat it? Yes. Is it a 12-inch black cock? I always fucking love it. Because it's so fast. I love it. They always said, is it animal, vegetable, or mineral? A bit of each.
eat it.